Hi everyone, welcome to our talk. How I use JSON deserialization zero day to steal money on the blockchain. I'm Ronnie, and my co-speaker, Zekai, will be present at part two. We are from Tencent Security Shenwu Lab. Our research fields include Android, web, IoT, browser, blockchain, etc. And our Shenwu Lab outputs many outstanding achievements such as BatTunnel. Here is the outline of our talk. First of all, I will introduce Fastjson briefly. Fastjson is a widely used open source JSON parser with 23,000 stats on GitHub. It's known for fast parsing speed. There are 3,600 artifacts using Fastjson on the Maven, and as a basic module of Hauntless Java web service, it serves hundreds of millions of users. In this part, I will detail the deserialization process and the security check in the Fastjson, and the vulnerability to bypass the check. First of all, there is a demo for JSON serialized and serialized using Fastjson. At the left side is a Java bin named user with a string field named name and the getter and setter for name. On the right, new a user object and set name to full using method json.toJSONString with flag serializer a feature dot read class name to serialize the user object to JSON string, and you can see the output of JSON. The key add type has a value user. This is the class name of the object, and the following is the field name. And then use method set auto type support to enable the auto type feature. Then using JSON dot pass method to deserialize this JSON string to a user object with name full. Take note of this line of code. Parser config set autotype support. Autotype is a very important feature of Fastjson deserialization. It's a flag about whether Fastjson can deserialize any non-presupposed classes automatically without other configuration. It's false in default. If you don't enable autotype, method JSON pass will throw a JSON exception about autotype is not supported when you pass the JSON with the @type user class. Next, I will detail the deserialized process inside the Fastjson. When the scanner catches the token key at type, the deserialized process will be started. First, the target class name will be checked by method checkAutoType. If the check is passed, method getDeserializer will return the deserialization constructor. The deserializer will be selected by the target type and finally, use the method createInstance of the object deserializer to get the object from JSON fields. Next, I will detail. Let's focus on the defense method checkAutoType and how to bypass it to deserialize attribute classes. The method checkAutoType has three parameters. Parameter type name is the target class you want to deserialize, and you can specify it explicitly. In the JSON, for example, at type user. The parameter expect class is the superclass or interface of the target class, and it can be none. And the last parameter feature is the deserialized flag. It's always default. Before we start detailing the check process inside check auto type, we need to know how to input a parameter of type class as the second parameter expect class. As we said, the expect class means the inheritance. There are two forms of inheritance in the Fastjson. The first one is explicit inheritance. You can start a JSON object string with two type keys. The first type value is the expect class, and the second one following is the subclass, which inherit from the expect class. And the fields following are the properties of the subclass. Another form is implicit inheritance. There is a demo. Class user has a field ID with interface full, and the class full import implements the interface full. So you can set the ID to a JSON object with type full import. That will trigger the implicit inheritance. The interface full is expect class, and the full import is the subclass. Okay, go back to the check auto type. This section, I will detail the control flow of the method check auto type and show you how to bypass it. The first line is the function prototype. First, if the target class is in the whitelist, or in the deserializer cache, or has the Fastjson annotation JSON type, it will pass the check. The target class will be returned and saved to the deserializer cache next. If not, if the target class is in the blacklist or inherited from JavaSQL rule set, data source, or class loader, the method will throw error and exit. If not, if the incoming parameter expect class is not null and is not those types, object, serializable, clonable, closable, event listener, collection, and the target class is assignable from expect class, it will pass the check, return at cache. If not, finally, it can't pass the check unless the global flag auto type support is true, but it's always false in the default configuration. To intuitively observe the cases past the autotype check, I list them as follows. First, enable the autotype support flag. It's a rare situation. Next, classes with an annotation JSON type. Those classes are not universal. We can't use them anywhere. Next, classes in the waitlist. Waitlist is initialized as a final static hash code list with about 60 classes, which are mainly related to Java Abstract Window Toolkit and Spring Framework. Those classes in waitlist are at high level, which are not easy to be extended. So the first three cases are not our first choice for bypass. Next, the classes in the deserializer cache. The last one, the second parameter abstract autotype, expect class and the subclasses of it. Especially note that the expect class is a parameter with type class instead of type string. That means the expect class has already passed the autotype check. It's converted from string type name to a text class. So the source of the expect class are the classes in the waitlist and the deserializer cache. So we focus on the deserializer cache. The cache is named type utils mappings. It's initialized in the method type utils at base class mappings for preloading the deserializer of basic types. At right, it's a part of the source code. You can see the class byte, int, boolean array, class object, and 8-bit clonable are added to the cache mappings. Although there are many low-level class and interface in the cache, those types have their own specified deserializer. For example, a class expect exception and a class error will be handled by throwable deserializer. A class hashmap and hashtable will be handled by map deserializer, but except the two types, Java util bit size and Java long auto closable. Fastjson will create a default Java bin deserializer for them. So any classes extend bit size or autoclosable can pass the autotype check and create an instant finally. So we can inherit from those classes to bypass the autotype check. The autoclosable is a very low level interface since JDK 7. It's the super interface of the most of stream classes, channel classes, and the connection classes, etc. The picture at the bottom is the sub-interface and the implementing classes listed in the JDK document. Those classes provide us with a broad search space to derive our gated chain. So finally, we bypass the autotype type check by Java long autoclosable. This is a poke for the bug. A JSON string with two autotype keys. The first one is the expect class, autoclosable, and the second one is the target class, Java IO reader, because reader inherited from autoclosable, so it will pass the check. In the previous section, I detailed how to bypass the check security check by autoclosable. In the next section, I will detail how to find some interesting gadgets to achieve remote code execute and more. Now we need to find out which classes we can derive and what we can do by those classes. The second question can be described as which methods can be called during deserialization. We call those methods magic methods. The method create Java bin deserializer is the main process of deserialization. And inside it, the main method of creating deserializer is Java bin info build. The parameter is the target class and type. First, in this method, it will select the constructor by the two method, get default constructor and get creator constructor. The order of choosing constructor is as following. After constructor, Fastjson will iterate and call all the setter methods of the target class. And next, there are some getter methods will be called automatically during deserialization, depends on the return type. Now we can answer the first question about the derivation. Except directly inherited from the interface auto-closable, there are four cases that classes will be added to the cache during the deserialization. At first, the class itself. Second, the types of the selected constructor's parameters. Next, the types of the parameters of the setter methods, including the types of public fields. And the last, a part of return types of getters. There is a very flexible feature named JSON path in the Fastjson. You can use it as an object query language. And what's more, what's even more amazing is that you can use it in the deserialization by the token key dollar reference. Following is a demo JSON. The key username has a value with key reference, which is $.useObject.name. The dollar means the root element is the entire JSON object itself. The huge object is the first key and the name is the field name in the huge object. It will call the getter method getName to get the value from the huge object. So JSON path will not only allow us to call arbitrary getters, but also allows us to cross-reference and access their properties on multiple generated instance when constructing objects during JSON passing. This feature greatly expands our magic method space. There are some conditions for gadgets classes. First, it must can be derived from auto-closable. Second, it must have a default constructor or constructor with symbols. Otherwise, it can't be initialized correctly. And third, it must not in the blacklist. In addition to those necessary conditions, we also have some quality requirements for gadgets. The gadgets should call the RCE, arbitrary file read and write, or other high-risk effects. And the dependence of gadgets should be in native JDK or in the widely used third-party libraries. There are almost hundreds of third-party packages widely used in the Java EE, and we need to search gadgets in nearly a million classes. It's impossible to pure manual search, so I write a tool based on the reflection to search the derivation of classes space. I rewrite the Fastjson deserialization process to check the derivation conditions and create a graph about derivation relations between classes. It's helpful when you reverse the chain from the sync class. And in addition, the tool can search available gadgets class in the JDK and the specified set of JAS. And I crawl common third-party libraries from Maven as input. There is a view shows how it generates almost 5,000 classes from the interface auto-closable. At the beginning, the yellow node is the interface auto-closable, and the green node is class JDK natural URL reader. The arrow and line mean derivation relation, and you can see the URL reader inherit from auto-closable, and then start searching. There are many colors of nodes. Different colors represent different types. The green node is class. The blue node is interface. The pink node is abstract class. The purple node is member class. So, after that, here are some high-risk gadgets we found in the third-party packages by the tool, such as using MySQL connector to RCE, using Apache Commons IO to read and write files, use JT to SSIF, etc. I will detail the gadgets, commons, IO read and write files in the next section about exploit the blockchain nodes. There are some Fastjson payloads to use MySQL connectors to RCE. Due to the difference between versions and the limitation of blacklist, you need to use different gadgets for different MySQL versions. Now we can control many important websites and affect millions of users by the Fastjson vulnerability. Let's make things more interesting. We found that this Fastjson vulnerability affects a public chain with multi-million dollar market value. And I will detail the RCE on the server node of blockchain Tron in the next. Tron is a public blockchain with a native cryptocurrency node as TRX. The market value of TRX is $5 billion, and it has 14 million holders. Besides, 1,400 of DApps are on the Tron network with a daily transaction volume of over $12 million. And the Java Tron is the Java implementation of the public blockchain protocol launched by Tron. It underlies all the decentralized applications in the Tron ecosystem. It's an open source Java application with 2,000 stars on GitHub. Java Tron can enable HTTP service on the Tron node to allow users and developers to interact with the blockchain. We will detail the Java Tron in the next section. In this section, we just need to know it's a HTTP service using Fastjson to pass JSON post data. Now we have a vulnerability can RCE or read and write any file on the on some conditions, but those conditions are not always met. First of all, there is no remote JDBC driver in the Java Tron, so we can't use the gadgets of MySQL connector, and there are some problems we need to be solved by for exploit by read and write file gadgets. The Java Tron is an independent Spring Boot Fastjson. So we can't write a web shell directly. We should think about what to write, and the jar can run with arbitrary user with network permissions. So we should think about where our writable paths. And the jar was run using Fastjson to decode post in the HTTP API request. However, there is no direct response by HTTP, but broadcast on P2P network. The HTTP response just only shows the state of the API request. So if we read files from a server node, how to get contents returned? Furthermore, the blockchain is decentralized. That means you take over more nodes, you get more control of the blockchain. So our exploit should rely on as few preconditions as possible. There are some common ways to get shell on a Spring Boot Fastjson server when you can write files. For example, you can overwrite system libs or write class file in the JVM class path, such as chastity.jar. But as I said above, root permission is not required. Those files can only be overridden by root, and overriding system or JVM lib is dangerous without the exact versions. There is a feature of JNI in the jar package. The binary library files need to be released to the file system before it can be loaded. This operation is usually in the static block trigger. In the static block, triggered when the class is loaded for the first time, and the binary library is always released to the directory specified by the system property java io temp directory. And the Java method system load will load the GISO file by function dir-open. So or reading the GISO file will be the best choice. Java Torrent use the LevelDB as local storage driver for blockchain data. LevelDB is a fast key value storage library and is used by Bitcoin. Therefore, it's inherited by many public chain. LevelDB saves the blockchain metadata which needs to pull in frequently for reading and writing. So Java Torrent uses the GNI driver. As I said, Java file needs to extract GNI library. LevelDB GNI extracts the ISO library in the method library extract and load. It extracts the GNI ISO file with a random suffix to the temp directory. So if we want to override the GNI ISO at runtime, we need to get the random file name extracted by the jar. The master directory is to list the temp directory, but we don't want those information to be broadcasted on the P2P network. And the last problem is that we need to write binary bytes instead of string with encoding. There are two things that can cause encoding confusion. The input JSON is read as a string with encoding instead of bytes, and the output stream and file writer should use bytes. We finally solved those problems by the gadget Apache Commons IO. This gadget can be combined with other classes to not only write but also read file. Let's start with write file gadgets, it's more clear. Look at the left side. The class comms IO input boom input stream inherits from autoclosable, so it can pass the autotype check. It has three parameters in the constructor: input stream delegate, boolean include, and a variable parameters of class byte order mark booms. There is a getter method for field boom in the boom input stream. Get boom will call the delegate read. We can set the field delegate to the class comms IO input T input stream. The method read of T input stream will write the input bytes to the field branch. The field branch can be set to an output stream in the constructor. So, using the class comms IO boom input stream, we can choose proper input and output stream classes to achieve write file. For writing encoding string, we can find out those gadgets just in comms IO package. Set the source input stream field input to char sequence input stream and send the field CIs to the input stream you want to write to file. And set the output stream field branch to writer output stream with class file writer with encoding. As for writing binary bytes, besides Apache Commons IO, we need to use two other packages in the Java Torrent. Set the field input of T input stream to Apache Commons codec binary base 64 input stream, which input of read is string and output is bytes. And set the field branch of boom input stream to Eclipse internal local store safe file output stream with which is from aspect jar. Next, this is how to use Apache Commons IO read files. The entry of gadgets is also the class boom input stream and its getter method, getBoom. It calls method matches in the getBoom. The method matches will iterate the field booms and compare every boom with the bytes read from the input stream delegate. If there is one boom, it's same as the bytes read from delegate. It will return the same boom. Otherwise, it will return none. So that will let us get the read content according to the different return states. It's a way of blind read. There is the payload for reading the temp directory to get the random file name. First, look at the number one at the right side. We use the class JDK natural URL reader as the input stream. The parameter URL supports file schedule, file scheme. The parameter URL supports file scheme for a folder and the listing directory. The number three, the field booms, is set to multiple bytes blocks to be compared with reader output. And the number four, use the JSON pass reference $abc.boom to call the getter method getBoom of the object abc, which is the first field in the JSON with the class boom input stream. And number five, let this reference value be the field address and send this JSON port data to the JavaTron HTTP API wallet validate address. And if the address is null, it will return nothing. If the address is bad format, it will return a validate failed message. So we can use Apache Comps IO to read the temp directory byte by byte and finally get the random file name of JNI library. Now we can override the JNI library at runtime. The last question is how to hijack pointer. The JavaTron will register a timer task for level DB write on initialization. The method DB write will call the JNI method native buffer JNI malloc. So we can inject shellcode to the offset address of JNI malloc when the timer task is executed, pong. This is a fun process of exploit. And the last step is recovering the program context to prevent the crash. For the sixth step, post penetration for real money, turn to my co-speaker Wu Zekai.
Next, I will introduce a post-penetration exploit method that affects the security of blockchain user sites. After we successfully RCE on Tron's HTTP node, we need to test whether it will cause losses to the user's sites. For the blockchain, the first approach we think of is a 51% attack. A 51% attack is an attack on blockchain by a group of miners who control more than 50% of the network's mining hash rate. Attackers with majority control of the network can interrupt the recording of new blocks by preventing other miners from completing blocks. And Tron uses a super representative mechanism. Any account can apply to be a super representative candidate. Every account can vote for super representative candidates. The top 27 candidates with the most votes are the super representatives. Super representatives generate blocks, package transactions, and get block and voting rewards. Therefore, we need to RCE on at least one half of the super representative nodes to cast a 51% attack. But the actual situation is somewhat unexpected. Not all nodes have HTTP service enabled. In other words, we can't attack all nodes of Tron. This picture shows the location and IP of all the nodes of the Tron network. This data is provided by the tronscan.org website. As shown by tronscan.org, Tron has 1,332 nodes in total. We scanned these IPs and found that only a quarter of the nodes can be accessed through the HTTP service. Therefore, there is no guarantee that more than half of the super representatives have enabled HTTP service. Unfortunately, we can use this vulnerability to cause a 51% attack on the Tron network. We need to find another way. Now let's focus on the Tron HTTP node itself and study what role the HTTP node plays in the Tron network. The Tron HTTP node has a variety of API calls to allow users to act with the blockchain. Some of the API calls serve as standalone requests to get individual pieces of information. The most important thing is that there are also many API calls which modify the user TRX wallet, resulting in a need to sign and broadcast the transaction. We mainly focus on the second type of API. These APIs will be used when users trade on the blockchain. When the user wants to send some TRX token to other users in the Tron network, three steps are required. First of all, the user needs to make a transaction and can call the wallet create transaction API to complete this step. The HTTP node will return a rogue transaction in JSON format. The second step is to sign the transaction. The user can call the wallet get transaction sign API. The HTTP node will use the private key provided by the user to sign the rogue transaction. The last step is to broadcast the transaction. The user can call the wallet broadcast transaction API. The HTTP node will broadcast the signed transaction to the blockchain. Therefore, after we RCE HTTP node, if the user uses the HTTP node to make a transaction, we can return a forged transaction, which will be executed after the user signs and broadcasts it. If the user uses the HTTP node to sign the transaction, we can steal the user's private key. If the users only use the HTTP nodes to broadcast the transaction, it seems that we can only prevent the transactions from being broadcast to custodians. Obviously, stealing private keys is more harmful than forged transactions, and the forged transactions are more harmful than DOS. In the Tron network, almost all users use wallet programs for transactions. TronLink is firstly launched at Tron's official website and backed by Tron Foundation. It is the Tron wallet with the most users. TronLink has three versions, including Chrome Wallet extension, iOS, Android. Among them, Chrome Wallet extension alone has more than 300,000 users. After testing three versions of TronLink Wallet, we found that all three wallets use HTTP nodes to broadcast transactions. In addition, Chrome Wallet extension also uses HTTP nodes to make transactions and directly sign and broadcast the transaction without checking the returned rogue transaction. So we can try to attack the wallet by returning forged transaction. When the wallet send a request to make a transaction to the HTTP node we control, we return a forged transaction. When the wallet signs and signs the transaction locally, and finally broadcast the signed transaction to the blockchain. We recorded a video to demonstrate this attack method. First, the victim treats normally. An Alice sends 100 TRX token to Bob. After that, the attacker executed the exploit program. And successfully RCE the HTTP node. And run the malicious program on the node. The victim makes the transaction again. and the attacker returned a forged role transaction. Finally, the attacker received the TRX tokens instead of ball. The attack is not over yet. Let's think about it. Wacker wallet extensions have different behavior from iOS and Android. After analyzing the source code of Chrome wallet extension, we found that it used the TronWipe library. TronWipe is to deliver a unified, seamless development experience influenced by Ethereum's Web3 implementation. TronWipe uses the TronWipe.TronTransactionBuilder.SendTRX method to make transactions, which will request HTTP nodes. As you can see in source code, when calling this method, the wallet creates transaction API of HTTP node will be requested to make a transaction. We realized that the TronWipe library would be a key point, so we investigated a variety of Tron-related applications and made some new discoveries. We found that in addition to TronLink Chrome wallet extension, some multi-currency wallets and dApps also use the TronWipe library. And they also didn't check the real transaction returned by the HTTP node. Multi-currency wallet is a wallet that supports multiple cryptocurrency transactions. mToken is a multi-currency wallet that supports Tron. mToken has 12 million users and it uses the Tron web library. After testing, we found that when mToken wallet generates Tron-related transactions, it does request the HTTP node. As you can see in the picture, we successfully forged the returned transaction, replacing two addresses with another address, and then signed and broadcast the forged transaction. DApp is a computer application that runs on a distributed computing system like blockchain. As of December 17, 2020, 1,400 dApps have been created on the Tron network, with a daily transaction volume of over $12 million. For a developer, dApp is a combination of front-end and smart contracts. TronWipe for front-end developer. Take a Poloniex dApp as an example. When TRX token are sent in this dApp, it will request HTTP nodes to make a transaction. We also successfully forged the return transaction, replacing two addresses with another address, and then signed and broadcast the forged transaction. In summary, the TronLink Chrome wallet extension with more than 300,000 users, the Tron part of the mToken multi-currency wallet with 12 million users, and DApps with a daily transaction volume of over 12 million, will all be affected. Finally, we make a conclusion. Although distributed and decentralized structure improves the credibility and fault tolerance of the system, blockchain is not a bulletproof of security vulnerability. And we hope our work can notify blockchain developers and users to be more careful about security. Our research on the future of blockchain security will include traditional web security, cloud and edge computing, and post-penetration exploit. Here is a vulnerability timeline. Special thanks to Song Kai, 周君宇, 刘慧明, and Yu Yang. Thanks.